Gwen Grant, the head of the Urban League, who I'm going to be introducing momentarily, and this really is just a long version of my introduction of Gwen. And I've been talking about the conversation on race for a while. We, of course, in Missouri, have been talking about and dealing with Ferguson, what's gone on at the University of Missouri, various things in the last week. Those of you who are reading the newspaper or watching TV or listening to NPR or whatever will know it was the one-year anniversary of the death of Freddie Gray, and there's a lot going on in Baltimore right now. And of course, you all know all the events that we've been watching around the country. Fortunately, not really in Kansas City, or at least not at that depth. But it tells us something about the importance of the kind of conversation that we're going to have tonight. And the library is heavily invested in that. And Gwen and I, together sometimes, sometimes apart, have been heavily invested in that. I can remember, and this I think this is a sign of both the good and the bad in our community. The Aspen Institute came into Kansas City a few years ago as a follow-up to the Time to Get It Right report on higher education, and part of which was about the huge racial gaps in Kansas City, and they got a bunch of civic leaders together to talk about this. And so we had a conversation at the Community Foundation about the importance of race and the conversation on race. And Gwen and I, as we sometimes do, kind of went at it about, you know, what that conversation should be. And we weren't agreeing on everything. And it was a little hot. And then we were going to have a follow-up meeting. And there were about 30 or 40 people, I think, in the meeting. And so we Gwen and I showed up for the follow-up meeting, and I think nobody else did. And so the Aspen Institute called me up after this, and they said, you know, we really saw that as a huge failure, and we were asking people about why they didn't come back and this thing, and we discovered that there was this thing that we, the Aspen Institute, are calling now Kansas City Nice. And the Kansas City Nice is about nobody wants to be critical of anybody else. Nobody want, and my version of that is nobody wants to have a serious discussion. And I think that is our problem. I think a large part of the community of a certain paler hue tends to march off into Johnson County, and there are organizations on this side of the line that notice that, and it raises hackles, and then everybody sort of backs off because we don't want to be seen as critical of each other. And I think that's a problem in this community. I think the city has to be more intentional, more purposeful about the problems that it wants to solve. Airports and streetcars and new buildings are all fine, but sometimes it's like the neutron bomb. You're left with the buildings and the people are forgotten. And I think we have that problem in this city right now. I think we have a lot of goodwill too. And I hope the library plays its role in this, and we are joined at the hip with Gwen and the Urban League. We don't always agree, but the annual review of Black Kansas City, which has graduated to Black Kansas City and Brown Kansas City, is held in the library. We've done programs, Gwen and I participated in the 10th anniversary of Whitney Terrell's novel, The King of Kings County, which is really about race, racial covenants in real estate, segregation in real estate in Kansas City. We appeared with Whitney and Emil Cleaver to talk about that. We've had a whole series of programs on race and racial issues over the last couple of years, and we will continue to do that. And I hope you all will help us participate. So it's a particular pleasure to introduce my friend, my sometimes combatant, fellow combatant in these conversations. But if we don't have this conversation, and Gwen is always willing to engage in it, and it's what the Urban League does, and the library is too, if we don't have these conversations, and have it in a group like this, a group, I think it's a public library group, which is to say you represent, I think, pretty much every part of our community. Then we're not going to move ahead. We're not going to get anywhere unless we do this. So, to my friend, the best dressed friend, you know, this is the only really expensive tie I ever bought, because whenever I'm with Gwen, I want to dress up, and then I dress up, and no one notices because Gwen's around, right? So, but she's my ideal in a lot of different ways. She's been running the Urban League for a long time. She's been a part of not just the conversation on race in Kansas City, but those other conversations we have to have about healthcare, about housing, about poverty in this community. And so it's a pleasure to welcome her to this stage to introduce our friends from the Kirwan Institute for this important program. Ladies and gentlemen, Gwen Grant.
Wow. I'm going to take him with me everywhere I go. So he can introduce me. Thank you, Crosby. That was really so kind of you. And, you know, thanks for sharing about how our relationship started, because we did start out kind of being totally at different ends of the spectrum on a number of issues, especially related to education. But what was so refreshing about it is that we were both willing to engage in authentic discourse with one another, and we didn't take it personal. And I was like, you know, he's very conservative on a lot of issues, and I had heard all this stuff about Crosby, and we get into this meeting, and we start to have these conversations, and I felt compelled to enlighten him, because he... And he, in turn, felt compelled to enlighten me. But what was so refreshing is that we both left there with so much more respect for one another that we started reaching out and engaging on a number of topics. So we would get together for lunch. We had a follow-up to that meeting. Like, we need to talk a little bit more about those issues. I need to share with you why I see this particular problem this way. So I encourage you to do the same, because that's how we get to really improving relationships across color lines, is when we can tear down those barriers and have those really honest conversations with one another, really duke it out if you have to, and then go have a drink of wine together. Do like the lawyers do. That's why I think, you know, the attorneys, they'll go and they'll fight it out in court, and then they'll go out and toss them back a few together and have a good time. So let's try that as well. So if you were here when we had the session with Whitney Terrell, I promised you that we were going to come back and have more conversation, and we would begin to talk about the impact of implicit bias in our community. Why is it that we have a truce dividing line in Kansas City? Why don't we see economic development more prevalent east of truce? Why do we continue to have this huge divide in education and health and injustice? And we believe that at the core of those problems, at the core of the disparities that are so persistent and so pervasive in our community, is the issue of unconscious bias, implicit bias, how it impacts our everyday decisions, and how those decisions then impact the systems and structures that bind us. So we're delighted to have this opportunity tonight, and I want to take this opportunity to say that, you know, Crosby gave me a lot of credit as the leader of the Urban League, but truly there's a team at the Urban League, and that team is driven by a very highly engaged and committed board of directors, and we have some of them here with us. So would you guys just please stand? I won't take time. Some of them are here sitting in front with us today and helped us to put this all together and make this possible. We also were able to do this because we have a really fantastic team of corporate sponsors and supporters. And so I want to give some credit to them. Of course, the Kansas City Public Library. We love doing events with the library. We do have the best library in the country, barring none, right? To Crosby and his staff, Carrie and Steve, all the people who work really hard behind the scenes to make these events happen, and they can turn it on a dime and move from upstairs to down here when we have this great turnout. They really do great work, and we really appreciate them. But we have the support of Hallmark Cards and Husch Blackwell, UMB Bank, Federal Reserve Bank, Reach Healthcare Foundation, UMKC, the Kauffman Foundation, and KCUR to help make this event possible. We have a week-long, well, 4 days of events engaging the Kirwan Institute and various sectors of Kansas City. This morning, we had a special event in Jackson County Circuit Court. And it was hosted by the presiding judge, Justine Del Muro, and the presiding judge-elect, John Torrance, who are seated over here, who, with Jeffrey Simon, the managing partner at Husch Blackwell, helped us to plan this event so that we could take a look at the impact of implicit bias in law enforcement and justice. So it was hosted in Division 4, the Circuit Court. We had judges, we had prosecuting attorneys, and we had command staff from the Kansas City Police Department listening to and engaging with Robin Wright and Maurice Stevens from Kirwan Institute about the impact of implicit bias in law enforcement. So that was a very significant beginning to more work to come in that area. Tomorrow, we'll be focusing on healthcare, and tomorrow's event is supported primarily by the Reach Healthcare Foundation, but we're going to look at how it impacts decision-making in healthcare and have an opportunity for those people to get really actively engaged in how they can identify it in their work, and more importantly, how do you address it. And then on Wednesday, we'll be focusing on employment at the Federal Reserve Bank. We'll have two sessions with corporate executives and HR professionals to look at how implicit bias impacts the workplace. And we'll wrap up the week with two events at the Kauffman Foundation, focusing on education, the impact of implicit bias in education at the secondary level, post-secondary level, and pre-K through 12th grade. So we've got an exciting week before us. More importantly, though, is when we get done with hearing all of this information tonight, I hope that you will pay particular attention to what you personally can do to address your biases. We all have them. I have them. We all have biases, and this is the beginning to making a difference for Kansas City. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Ms. Robin Wright. Robin Wright is a researcher and training facilitator within the Race and Cognition Program at the Kirwan Institute for the Study of Race and Ethnicity. In this role, Robin works to expand our understanding of the ways in which unconscious cognitive forces influence our behavior and contribute to racial disparities in our society. She has facilitated trainings with dozens of institutions across the country, including educators, police officials, court personnel, healthcare providers, social workers, and more. Additionally, Robin is the co-author of the most recent editions of the State of the Science Implicit Bias Review, a comprehensive review detailing the real-world implications of implicit racial bias. She attained her master's in public administration from the John Glenn College of Public Affairs at The Ohio State University, as well as a Bachelor of Arts in Pan-African Studies from Kent State University. Welcome, Ms. Robin Wright.
Thank you. Oh, you're taking that? Okay. I wasn't expecting that to be moved. That's great. Oh, it's fine. You can take it. You can take it. I take it you all can hear me. I hear the echo. So let's talk Oscars. So the Oscars is passed, right? So you may be thinking this is pretty old news. But you might recall the most recent Oscars and also the year prior to this year, there has been a lot of controversy around who has been nominated for Best Actor and Actress, and also Best Supporting Actress and Actor. And for the second year in a row, it was a cast of entirely white individuals nominated. And so it's interesting because if you think about the Oscars and that nomination process, there's over 6,000 individuals who are in that decision-making process for who deserves to be nominated each and every year. And if you think about the vast diversity of our nation and of our entertainment industry, it's pretty hard to believe that 2 years in a row we have an entirely white cast. So coming from the Kirwan Institute, we do a lot of work in communities, we're a very engaged research institute. We do a lot of work on the ground with communities, everyday individuals, helping to solve real problems using research, using our research expertise and also collaborations and partnerships. And one of the things that we've learned through this engagement in the community is that more often than not, people are well-meaning. Our explicit, our
outward beliefs more often than not are very much egalitarian. We have good intentions. But we know also from research about how our minds work that and how things occur in our society that oftentimes those good intentions don't always manifest into good outcomes. Hence, you have 6,000 individuals collectively making a decision that in and of itself is statistically improbable. And if you were to ask those individuals, what was the criteria by which you made that decision? Each and every one of them would assert that they were using objective criteria and that clearly these individuals were just the most talented. And clearly this was just the best product that was out throughout the year. They would assert egalitarian and fair values, but we know from the science that more often than not, being the people that we're striving to be is a lot harder than we think. We have good intentions, we have good explicit values, but oftentimes there's a disconnect. And so a tension continues to emerge in our society where outcomes are not happening in a way that aligns with our explicit beliefs. And so that's what we're here to talk about today. What are our blind spots? How can we begin to uncover those blind spots and use this understanding to help us move throughout the world? So with that, I want to start with the video. This video here is just to really introduce this notion of bias and to really disarm this idea of bias and what this actually means in our community and how this actually impacts how we move throughout the world. So eventually, hopefully, the video will start. Oh, yeah. So this is a video that we want to show really to introduce this notion of bias and hopefully start to take away some of the negative connotation and some of the weight of that term. It's just scroll up, please. Scroll up. You're on the right page. Just scroll up. Scroll up. There you go. Full screen and hit play. Thank you so much.
Well, this would make one.
Oh, yeah. Me too. What do you do?
I'm a vet.
I love animals.
Really? Where are you from?
Michigan, born and raised. Go Blue.
So, we show this video for several reasons, and none of which have anything to do with our ties to the Ohio State University. And believe it or not, people at Ohio State get really, like, tense if you don't put the in front of it. Like, I remember in grad school literally being told by my career advisor, if you don't put the in front of it on your resume, there are people who will not hire you because of that. So luckily, I didn't have to worry about that. I ended up staying connected to the university at the Kirwan Institute. But that's not, however, why we show the video. We show this video when we start out these discussions with folks about implicit bias for three reasons. First and foremost, to demonstrate that despite the negative connotations of the word bias, bias in and of itself is a neutral term. If you actually look up what bias means, it's just a positive or negative inclination toward or against a person, an idea, concept, something. It's a positive or negative inclination. So if you think about this video, the gentleman in that video, you could very much say that he had a negative bias against Michigan, right? But you could also say that he had a positive bias toward Ohio State. Bias in and of itself is a neutral term. And the second reason we bring this video to your attention is to really distinguish between implicit and explicit. So this gentleman very clearly knew his biases, right? So much so he rolled out of a moving vehicle to proclaim to the world where his allegiance lied. That's explicit bias. It's those biases we know. But the conversation we're going to have today has to do with those biases, those mechanisms that's operating in our brain that perhaps we're not aware of, that's happening underneath the surface, that we're not able to roll out of a vehicle and proclaim about. So perhaps you go on a blind date, and then you leave that blind date, you go back to your homeboys, and you're like, you know, I just wasn't feeling her. And they're like, oh, why? And you're like, I can't quite put my finger on it. I just really wasn't feeling her. You know, perhaps you can't articulate what it is about that woman that makes you not want to return to that blind date. Nonetheless, you're still making the same decision to not continue your relationship, building a relationship with this person. So the outcome is the same, even if you can't articulate the reasoning behind the outcome. And then the third reason we show this video, really to set the stage of what kind of conversation this is going to be tonight. So, as I said, bias has such a negative weight. But if you think about it, most people, especially outside of Ann Arbor and Columbus, won't say that that gentleman is a good or bad person for his biases for Ohio State and against Michigan. Same way for that woman in the video. Most people won't call her a good or bad person because of her collegiate allegiance. We're not going to be having a conversation about being a good or bad person today. So if you came here and you're like, oh my gosh, they're going to tell me that I'm racist and biased, take a deep breath and relax. This is not going to be that kind of conversation. Instead, we're going to be talking about how our minds work. What does this mean? How does this impact how we move throughout the world? And how can we begin to understand this and move forward in a way that aligns with our goals as a collective community? So this brings me to the goal for this conversation. First and foremost is to help you think differently about the way you think. I'm going to take you all through a few exercises, and I invite you to engage with me. This isn't going to be just a one-way experience. You're going to have to participate, so clear your throat a little bit and get ready to engage with me. These exercises are going to be extremely simple. It's not the exercise itself so much. It's what the exercise is going to show us about how our minds work and what that actually means. And then the second goal is to connect some of the insights and the research that we know from the work that we do at the Kirwan Institute to what it actually means for your day-to-day lives. How does this actually play out in our society? In this case, I'm just going to share one academic study that actually takes place in a legal context, but is very much applicable to employment processes, just as an example. And then we can discuss a little bit about what that means for interactions with different folks. And then lastly, I hope to create a space where you can start to consider that gap between intentions and outcomes. The goal here is to challenge you to really think critically about what decisions you're making, how you're moving throughout the world, and what this actually means. So with that, I want to establish a little bit of understanding. How many of you walked into this room having known or heard of the words implicit bias? Almost the entire room. And I can guarantee that there's probably as many people as who raised their hands, there's that many different definitions in this room of implicit bias. So just for some common language here, make sure we're on the same page. At the Kirwan Institute, when we say implicit bias, we're talking about those attitudes and those stereotypes that affect our understanding, that affect our actions and our decisions in an unconscious, or you might say preconscious or subconscious manner. It's those things that's happening underneath the surface in our cognitive processes that are impacting how we move throughout the world. That's why at the Kirwan Institute and at the Urban League also, that's why we're invested in this idea of understanding this and the need to expand this knowledge because it matters. Even though bias is not inherently bad, good and bad biases have impacts in our society. So that leads me to the first part, how our brains process the world. We're going to show one more video here, and if you've seen this video, please do not spoil it for your friends and neighbors next to you. But what you're going to see in this video, you all can start going to, thank you. What you're going to see in this video is two basketball teams. Each team is going to be passing the basketball to members of their own team. Your task tonight is just to count the number of passes the team that's wearing the white shirts make. You ready? Here we go.
Is an awareness test. How many passes does the team in white make?
Go!
All right, anyone have an answer? 13. Okay, 12, 13, 14. We know it's one of those. It's 13. So here's the million-dollar question. How many of you saw the moonwalking bear? About 10 people. You didn't see it? You didn't see the moonwalking bear? Okay, let's play it again. All right, pay attention.
Is an awareness
yeah,
test.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
How many passes does the team in white make?
Go!
Thank you. So it's kind of hard to believe the second time watching that through that it's possible to miss something as obvious as a moonwalking bear in the middle of a basketball game. Don't feel bad. This isn't a trick to try to make you feel silly. I missed it the first time I watched it as well. But this video actually shows us a few things about our cognition. And before I do that, is there a way to dim this light? Folks in the front middle are saying it's difficult to see the screen. So if there is a way, that will be very helpful. Thank you. Hopefully we can work that out for you all. But yeah, so this video actually tells us some really important things about how our minds work. First and foremost, it shows us that we can be blind to the obvious, in a sense that most of us, the first time watching this through, are blind to that moonwalking bear. And then secondly, it demonstrates that we can be blind to our blindness, in a sense that you didn't realize you were missing something when you missed that moonwalking bear. It's possible for us to miss the obvious, especially when we're not expecting to see it. If it's not something that would typically take place in that context, we're more likely to miss it. And this is because our conscious processing capacity has limitations. Quite frankly, we have limits on how much information we can take in at a conscious level at any given moment in time. Researchers have actually begun to look into this, and this research dates back to the 50s. Psychologists have begun to explore how much are we able to process consciously at any given time. And the figures that they've landed on is about 7 plus or minus 2 pieces of information at any given time. You ever wonder why our phone numbers are 7 to 10 digits, right? So imagine someone, you're writing down someone's phone number, someone else interjects and says, oh, hey, so-and-so. You forgot at least 4 of the 7 numbers, right? You never make it because your conscious processing capacity has been reached. And so you literally are not able to take in that additional information at a conscious level. And so if you may have heard of the iceberg. Great, thank you. Is this better? Yeah, so you may have heard of the iceberg analogy, wherein the portion of the iceberg that you see above the surface is just a small fraction of the whole. You can think of our cognition in a very similar way, in that the portion of our cognition that's actually conscious is just a fraction of the whole. So for instance, this portion above the water and the iceberg will be our conscious processing capacity. That's that 7 plus or minus 2 pieces of information. In contrast, our unconscious mental processing capacity is so large that researchers have been unable to actually put a maximum limit on it. It's millions upon millions, if not unlimited processing capacity. The reality is, although as adults, we think of ourselves as being conscious, very decisive, executive functioning individuals, and we are in many ways, but the vast majority of our decision making, the vast majority of the information that we process is happening underneath the surface. So I'm gonna take you all through a few activities now. On the next slide, what you're gonna see are 3 pairs of words. And each word will be followed by the word and then a blank. I'm gonna say the word, I'll say and when I get to the blank, I want you all together to fill in that blank out loud. All right, here we go. Night and,
day.
Black and,
white.
Young and,
old.
Oh. It's interesting because usually with an audience this large, someone says restless. And it did not happen, so I'm actually a little bit shocked about that. It almost never fails. But let's think about this. This is probably one of the easiest things you've been asked to do all day, right? Give me what's in those blanks. And let's actually take a moment and step back and think about how significant this is about our mental processing. Not only did you all fill in these blanks really easily, automatically, without effort, with extraordinary speed, you all filled in the blanks with the same words. Meaning that it's possible for us to have shared associations. And in fact, you were filling in these blanks so quickly that you were probably waiting on me to get to the line so that you could hurry up and say it. You're sitting there like, oh my gosh, if she will hurry up. You know, if there's like a person in our unconscious minds, that person was saying that like, huh, she's taking forever. You know, so, but that's the reality of our unconscious processing. That's how our minds work. It's automatic, it's super fast, and we can have shared associations. But you may be thinking this is fairly orderly, correct? You know, obviously I'm just looking for a word in those blanks. There was some sort of rhythm to the exercise. But let's think about what other characteristics there are of our unconscious minds. Because what I think is perhaps the most fascinating element of our unconscious processing is that we can make sense of the world when it doesn't make any sense whatsoever. So on this next slide, I'm gonna put a paragraph up here, and I just want you all together to read the paragraph out loud. This is gonna be tricky to stay cohesive, but I believe in you. Read the paragraph out loud. You ready? Here we go. According to... That's hilarious. I actually think it was probably more challenging to block out all the other words and read than it was to read the slide. That's, you all did great. So this is quite fascinating. If you look at this paragraph, it's horrific. And if there are any educators in the audience, I really do apologize. I know this is a living nightmare. One of my oldest siblings is a teacher. She teaches elementary school. And she complains about kids like writing out you text. I can only imagine if a kid sent this to her, right? But let's actually think about it. You all were able to read this paragraph quite fluently, and you were able to do it quite quickly. That's the power of our unconscious processing. You weren't sitting there and saying, you know, maybe if I move that S a few spaces to the right and the E a few spaces to the left, I'll get researcher. That's not what was happening. Your unconscious processing capacity was taking those messes of letters together, reflecting it back with words you already knew, and sending you the correct words. And it was doing so quickly and so easily that it hardly at all slowed down the rate at which you were able to read this paragraph. That's our unconscious processing. It makes sense of the world, even if the world makes no sense at all. Another element of our unconscious minds that's really important to know is that we often make sense of very ambiguous situations using context. So, when you see this, what do you see? What do you see now? What do you see now? Isn't that quite fascinating? The first time I saw this, I was like, no way, this is a trick. I promise you these are not tricks. And I promise you that we've all at the Kirwan Institute gone through all of these exercises for the first time at some point and had the similar, like, what effect? So don't feel bad. You're in good company. But let's think about this. That middle character never changed. It never changed. But how we made sense of that middle character changed depending on what was surrounding it. That's our unconscious minds. We're not asking the question of, what information don't I have here? We're taking this incomplete and ambiguous information, and we're making sense of it based on whatever information is around it and whatever associations that we have. That's our unconscious processing. So the question is, what does our conscious processing capacity bring to the table? Let's take a look at this example. You almost feel your brain grinding to a halt. Like, goodness, this is actually an example of both unconscious and conscious processing. Our unconscious mind saw this math problem and immediately recognized it as a math problem. Immediately knew it was a multiplication problem and immediately knew it was solvable. We even actually had some sort of range of where the answer lied. We knew it was probably more than 10 and pretty confident it was less than 10,000. But to actually solve this problem, you have to engage your conscious processing capacity to actually get a real answer. Any takers? Anyone have an answer? 408. 420, it's 408. Good guesses. So it never fails. Someone ignores me and starts solving the problem. You just can't help yourself. I understand. I do it too. But 408. So yeah, that's our conscious processing. So now let's take one more example where we actually look at what actually happens when we have our conscious processing and our unconscious processing sometimes working in coordination with one another, and sometimes with a little bit of tension, where we're doing some, we're being asked to do something consciously that's contradicting our unconscious inclinations. What does that feel like? What does that actually look like? So on the next slide, on the left-hand side, you're gonna see a column of words. You're gonna see an arrow that's gonna appear, and the arrow's gonna animate, and it's gonna scroll down each of the words. And as it goes past each word, all I want you to do is tell me what color font the word is written in. Don't read the word. I don't care if it's zoo animals. Just tell me what color font the words are written in. You ready? Here we go. Oops. Pretty easy, right? Pretty easy. Let's do the same exercise on the right-hand side. Again, it's going to be a column of words, and if you're probably familiar with this exercise, every time we come to this portion, people get that big grin on their faces. It's like, I know where she's going with this. But even, you know, continue to play along with me in this exercise. Let's do the same exact thing on the next side. On the right-hand side, a column of words are going to appear. The arrow's going to animate at the same rate, and I just want you to tell me what color font the words are written in. Here we go. So let's think about what actually happened here. On your left, okay. Yeah, on that left-hand side, you were able to zip right through that. You know your colors and your color words since you could read. You know, so you were able to pair that together like, oh, I got this red, blue, orange, blah, 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 blah. You were able to go through that with no effort whatsoever, no difficulty. But on that right-hand side, in order to actually do the exercise correctly, as I was asking you all to do, you had to actually slow down a little bit. Your unconscious processing, your automatic processing was like, oh, I got this, I can do this, and you just going along. And you actually have to be intentional and force yourself to slow down and engage your conscious processing to do the exercise correctly. Two things happen when most people try to do this exercise. This is actually called a Stroop task. It's a psychology test. This exercise, two things tend to happen. First, individuals tend to make more mistakes when they're trying to do that pairing on the right-hand side. You're just more prone to errors. It's associations, it's connections that you're not familiar with. You're not used to being exposed to. And then second, you have to actually slow down and engage your conscious processing in order to do it correctly. This notion is really pivotal. And this premise of those associations and pairings that we're familiar with are quickly and easily able to be paired, and those we're not familiar with take us more time and we're more likely to make mistakes when we're instructed to pair them, is really pivotal to a test known as the implicit association test. This implicit association test debuted in 1998 by Dr. Anthony Greenwald and some of his colleagues. Actually, he was at The Ohio State University at the time that he began developing this assessment. This assessment is free and publicly available at implicit.harvard.edu. And it's just actually measuring the relative strength of our associations. It's measuring how quickly and how easily are we able to pair certain concepts together as opposed to other concepts, with the premise being that if it's easy and quick for us to pair those things together, then those are associations that are really strong and prevalent in our minds. And if it's difficult, then perhaps we're not as familiar with those associations. So just to give you some examples of the implicit association test, this actually comes from the race, African-American, European-American implicit association test. These are just some screenshots. And as you see here, the test is really just a matching game. You have a prompt that shows up in the middle, and you're given a key for the left-hand side and a key for the right-hand side. And as the prompt shows up, you're just instructed, and as quickly as you can, to actually put that prompt in the correct category. As you see here, in some cases, you have faces, and each side just has one category. In other instances, you have words, also with good words and bad words in each side. In other cases, those things are paired together. So you may be asked to pair European-American faces and positive words together in the same side, and African-American faces and negative words in the same side, and vice versa. There's about 7 trials. The test takes less than 10 minutes. But it tells you whether you have a strong, moderate, slight, or no bias or preference toward or against another individual or a group of people. What's really interesting about this is, you know, as you might imagine, if you have a test that seems just this simple, right, like this is pretty basic as far as the matching game, you tend to get a lot of pushback. There's no way this is actually measuring real implicit associations, but this test has actually been rigorously studied by scholars all throughout the nation, and it has really upheld nearly 2 decades of research that looks at its reliability and also its validity. And so for that reason, among others, it's one of the assessments that we often uplift. So there's several different types of implicit association tests available. I gave you screenshot examples from the race, black, white, but there's so many different others. And similar to that definition that I shared earlier about attitudes and stereotypes, there's attitude-focused implicit association tests, and there's also stereotype-focused implicit association tests. In a stereotype ones, you're being asked to pair, for instance, the gender science. How easily are you able to prepare words related to science and technology with women versus men, as opposed to words related to liberal arts? Or with the gender career one, how strong are your stereotypes and your associations between women with careers versus women with things related to home and nurturing and caregiving versus males in those two categories? This is measuring your associations so quickly, in milliseconds, really honing in on the characteristics of our unconscious processing. Things happen so quickly, so automatically. And it's looking at how many mistakes are we making, how quickly are we able to correctly pair these things, and using that as a basis for what is the strength of our associations. So, what does this actually teach us about how our minds work? How does this actually connect to understanding the key things that we need to take away from these exercises? First and foremost, it shows us that our brains are constantly connecting ideas. It's constantly pairing things together as a way of making sense of the world. It helps us to move throughout the world in an efficient and effective manner. So, one of the ways that we make these connections is through a process called classical conditioning. If you've gone to college and had any psychology courses, you might be familiar with Pavlov's dog theory. There's a researcher, he had a dog, and like most dogs, you feed your dog begins to salivate. And so Pavlov decided to start an experiment where he would ring the bell every time he went to feed his dog. And he would do that each and every time he fed his dog. He did so much that his dog became conditioned to see that bell as meaning he's about to eat. And so even in the absence of the food, the dog had the same physiological response to that bell. The dog was conditioned to see those things as associated with one another. And obviously, this is an experiment that took place with a dog, but we know that human minds work the same way. And a great example of this is advertising and branding. So if I show you the Starbucks logo, what do you think of? Coffee. But let's actually look at this. That's a distorted association. There's nothing about that logo that says coffee. I mean, seriously, like if someone offered me green coffee, I would not eat it. I would not drink it, I mean. That's a distorted connection. Yet we've been exposed to that branding so much that we see that logo and we think, oh, coffee. Even if you're not a coffee drinker, you think some caffeinated beverage. It's quite ridiculous because on the way here or one of our earlier engagements, we rolled past a Starbucks and I was like, Starbucks. I don't even like Starbucks coffee. It's a little too tart, but I still had an inclination to get it. So that's the power of these associations. That's branding at its finest. That's what advertisers spend their time getting us to form these connections. That's classical conditioning. And what's key about this is those pairings don't have to make sense. Again, there's nothing about this. They do not have to make sense. But if we're inundated with that messaging, we begin to pair those things together. This also works with auditory associations. So I'm gonna sing a jingle and you all tell me what you think of. Ba da ba ba ba, I'm loving it. McDonald's. Everybody knows that jingle. Even if you don't eat McDonald's, you know that jingle. And again, there's nothing about that actually says McDonald's. I don't go to McDonald's and walk out like, ba da ba ba ba, you know. I'm sure that's what they want us to do, but it just doesn't happen. And so, again, these associations can be distorted, overgeneralized. They do not actually have to make sense. But if we're exposed to it, we can still see those things as connected. So let's bring this around to people. So if you frequently see images of African-American males being paired with things related to crime, it's very easy for us to form an association of black men as being dangerous. So much so that even in the absence of that crime stimuli, we can still have the same physiological response to the presence of a black male as though that person was engaging in something that was actually dangerous. This is really key. Let's actually look at an example of this, a real-world example from Hurricane Katrina. If you look at these photos, for all intents and purposes, these individuals are doing the same thing, trying to survive a horrific situation. But let's look at what the media write-ups were. For the top, the Associated Press says, a young man walks through chest-deep flood water after looting a grocery store in New Orleans. Those two individuals on the bottom, two residents wade through chest-deep water after finding bread and soda. So on the top, that gentleman is looting a criminal act. In the bottom, those two residents were just finding bread. But in reality, we all know, especially being able to take a step back and look at it more objectively, we know they were just trying to survive a very horrific and unfortunate situation. But that's not how the media portrayed it. We're constantly being inundated with these messages about different groups of people. And it's not often that we're able to pair these things together the way that we presented it to you all tonight. But the reality is we're still taking in those messages. It's causing us to form associations, and it's impacting how we move throughout the world. So what else does this tell us, these exercises tell us? So we know that those exercises showed us that we're making these connections, and we're filling in those, you're able to fill in those blanks using these associations. It also tells us that in moments of ambiguity, our unconscious processes tend to take the driver's seat. So look at this photo. Where do you think this family is sitting? Any takers? In the basement. That's a very specific room in a house. That's an interesting one. I haven't had that one before. But yeah, so it's interesting. It's not an incorrect response. We don't actually know, right? It's ambiguous. That's the nature of it. But what's interesting is this picture was used in a research study. And when shown to individuals in Western societies like our own, they say something to that end, in a basement, in a room, a living room, something of that sort, some sort of house or building structure. This same photo, when it was shown to individuals in East Africa who were in a remote village outside of the city where their structures tended to be more round, they actually said this family was sitting outside in front of a tree and that thing over the lady's head is her balancing something on her head. Context matters. Again, in ambiguous situations, we're not asking what information are we missing. We're taking that information and we're making sense of it based on what other data we have based on our lived experiences and messages we've been exposed to. That's our unconscious processing system. Number three, these exercises show us that if our cognitive capacity is being compromised, then we're more likely to miss information and to act and make decisions on our unconscious processing. So in that moonwalking bear video, the awareness test video, you missed that information because your conscious processing capacity was maxed out. And so, yes, it's when you're over inundated with information, but it's also when the stakes are really high. If you're making a decision and the stakes of that decision, the results of that is really, really high, that heightened stress is actually going to impede on your ability to make an objective decision, whether you know it or not. And then also, just something as simple as being fatigued. If you don't get enough rest the night before you go into work and you're making these decisions about who you're hiring, or if you're exhausted, you actually have a reduced cognitive capacity, and you're more likely to operate on that unconscious processing. And then number four, it shows us that when we're working under intense time pressures, we are more likely to rely on those implicit associations. So in that Stroop test with the color words, those arrows were moving at the same rates. And that time pressure, we are all like, I want to keep up with the arrow, I want to keep up with the arrow. And you're reverting back to that initial inclination, your gut inclination of reading through those words. Our unconscious processing takes the driver's seat. And it's also important to note that our implicit attitudes may not necessarily align with our explicit beliefs. So on this slide, on the next three slides, I want to share a little bit of data with you all. I just discussed like what the implicit association test is and gave you some examples from the race IAT. This is actually some aggregate data that was taken from the race implicit association test just recently by some researchers who were looking at what is that difference between how people IAT results demonstrated their biases to be and what their explicit self-reported biases were. The first one's gonna look at white individuals, the next African Americans, and then third, and most interestingly for me, those individuals who identified as both African American and white. What were the distinctions between their implicit and explicit? In all three graphs, I know it's a little difficult to see on this screen, but in all three graphs, the black bars are explicit and the white bars are implicit. So for white individuals, as you might imagine, nearly 50% said no bias. But when you actually looked at the implicit association test results, the vast majority skewed a lot more toward that strong pro-white bias. For African-American individuals, the skewed explicitly toward pro-black and no bias. Implicitly, that distribution was a lot more even than the explicit. Most interestingly, biracial individuals, the vast majority, as you might imagine, identifying in both categories would say no bias. Implicitly, it wasn't as overwhelming as the explicit. The reality is, regardless of what our own identities are, again, this isn't a conversation intended to be about being a good or bad person, because we know from research that even if you can have negative associations, even of identities that you carry, it's not about being a good or bad person. It's about understanding that our minds are taking in information, we're taking in these messages, and we're using that information in how we move throughout the world, and it's affecting our perceptions of others. So what's the big idea of this section? First and foremost, the big idea is that the vast majority of our cognition is unconscious. The vast majority of the ways in which we perceive and move throughout the world is underneath the surface of the water, in that lower part of that iceberg. The vast majority is unconscious. Secondly, we know that our associations can be formed based on skewed and distorted information, like in the logo example or the McDonald's jingle, skewed and distorted information, and they may not necessarily align with our explicit beliefs. And then third, it's important, especially at an individual level, as you start to really challenge yourself, hopefully moving from this conversation forward with what your implicit associations are, what it means, and how you can begin to change them, the implicit association test is really a great tool to uncover that. There's other methods, but this is one that's free and available online and has been rigorously studied. So what does the research say? What does this actually mean for how we move throughout the world? So I had a study here that originally I wanted to share with you all. And I'm gonna still share it, but there's another study that I'm gonna talk about that I don't have slides for, but I'm nonetheless gonna talk about, because I think the longer that we've been here in Kansas City and we're picking up on some of the cultural climate here, coming from Ohio, we don't know your community the way that you know your community, but there's another study that I think you all will find valuable when it pertains to, as what Gwen was talking about as she introduced me, how do you move forward as a city with going beyond just investments economically, but actually how you interact with one another. So this study, first, before I jump into the study, it's important to note that our blind spots can occur on any number of identities. I've talked primarily about race and ethnicity. We are the Kirwan Institute for the Study of Race and Ethnicity. And so much of the data in this implicit social cognition realm lies within that area, and specifically it's not very diverse outside of African American and white. And we know that the world is not black and white, and that's not the only inequities that exist in our society. But nonetheless, that's where the literature is right now, and hopefully you can take this knowledge and carry it through into other identities. But it's important to know that there are other identities that are necessary to think about in this context, and our identities are complex. You see, these are overlapping circles. They're not separate. We lie within all of these different areas, and the intersections of these identities can surface different associations, and so it's important to know that. So for this study, I forgot about this slide. So just an example of this, if I asked you to think of a leader, how many of you actually think of a woman? According to the implicit association test, most of us do not. What about if you're asked to think of what your associations are of an Asian American student? Is this, you're assuming that that person is intelligent? What about your associations of African American girls? Do you see them as aggressive? Are you mistaken passion for aggressive? Are you perceiving them as being angry? What are those associations? These are very much hypothetical, but they're based on literature and what we know about how our perceptions are. So again, these identities are really complex, and it's important to recognize all of those intersections. So to get to the study here, this, as I said, it takes place in a legal context, but it's very much applicable to so many other realms. This study has to do with a writing analysis. So the researchers actually sent out a fictitious writing analysis to 60 different law firm partners throughout the United States. And they did two things to these writing samples. They told the individuals, we want to gauge perceptions within the field, the law field, about how you think recent graduates are as far as their writing capacity. And so each partner was given a writing sample that had Thomas Meyer as the author, third-year law associate, graduated from NYU Law, and they were told to analyze, you know, what are the spelling errors, the technical errors, do you see any analytical problems with this writing, what's your overall perception of this person's writing capacity. They did two things to these samples, though. In one instance, they changed the racial identifier. So as you see here, some partners received the writing sample that was African-American Thomas Meyer and others that were a Caucasian Thomas Meyer. And then they also intentionally embedded errors. So there were actually errors in these writing samples for the law firm partners to see. And the writing samples, again, identical outside of the racial identifiers. And they got the data back and they examined how was these perceptions of these different samples. As you'll see, all the red bars are African American, all the gray bars are Caucasian. And overall, they found that the partners found more errors in the memo that was perceived to be written by the African American Thomas Meyer. In terms of spelling errors, there were 7, found nearly 6, a high 2. Technical errors, there were 6 embedded, almost 5, a low 4. Factual errors, there were 5 embedded. The partners found nearly 4 and 3.2 for the white Thomas Meyer. As you might imagine, overall on the scale of 1 to 5, when they were asked to rate them overall, it skewed as well, where the Caucasian Thomas Meyer received a higher rating than the African-American Thomas Meyer. Perhaps what's most startling, though, are the comments. They also asked the law firm partners to just give them some comments on the overall quality. For the African-American Thomas Myers, the comments were things like, need lots of work, can't believe he went to NYU, talk about an insult, right? Do all that work to get to any law school, let alone NYU, and someone to insult that is just so, it's ridiculous. Average at best. The same memo, same exact errors embedded, perceived to be written by the white Thomas Meyer. Generally good writer, but needs to work on, has potential. Good analytical skills. Let's think about that. Significantly different evaluation, identical memos, and these are real, currently in the field, law firm partners. And they rated these memos very different based on the perceived racial descriptor. So the researchers looked at this and they're like, okay, what's going on here? And one of the things that they really found as a way of understanding what was happening is this notion of unconscious confirmation bias. It's that tendency to see things that we're expecting to see and to just miss things that we're not expecting to see. Sounds familiar, right? The Moonwalking Bear video, miss things that we're not expecting to see. The researchers have found that we have that inclination, and it can happen consciously, but it can also happen unconsciously. So just a comic here to demonstrate. It says, I've heard the rhetoric from both sides. Time to do my own research on the real truth. Goes to Google, literally the first link that you see that agrees with what you already believe. Jackpot. We all do it, and it's getting worse too. Like if you think about social media, you get on Facebook and they just show you the people that you agree and like their stuff the most. But it's like, I got over 1,000 friends, and I'll pretty much only see 25 of my Facebook friends on my timeline. So, you know, it's not helping that media and these online vehicles are actually giving us what they think we want first. We're doing this as we move throughout our world. We're having these unconscious inclinations that align with our core beliefs, and we don't even realize we're doing it. So there's two ways you can actually look at this study. First, you can say that the partners expected more errors and less quality from the memo that was perceived to be written by the African-American male, but you can also say that they expected fewer errors and higher quality in a memo perceived to be written by the Caucasian Thomas Meyer. This is critical because, as I said, bias in and of itself is a neutral term. So those errors that they found were actually there. They didn't imagine errors in that memo. They found errors that were there. But the question is, who was given that presumption of competence? Who was given the benefit of the doubt that this person was going to be a good writer, and therefore they just happened to miss some of the errors? And who was not given that same benefit? Again, we're not talking about being a good or bad person, but how are our associations guiding how we perceive the world and how we interact with others? And so, it's 7:30 now, and I want to be respectful of your time. So I'm going to go to a quote, and we can talk afterwards if you all have questions. We're going to have some mics set up after we go through the last session here, and you can ask questions. But it is important to note that there are a lot of studies also that looks at interactions, and something that manifests oftentimes is microaggressions. You know, and so you have a society. We live in a country where people of color are parading around, there's racism, and then you have very well-meaning white people who are like, what are you talking about? I treat everybody fairly. And the thing is, we know that the goal may be to treat everybody fairly, but there's a lot of research that shows that we literally, physically and non-verbally interact differently with people that we have negative associations with, even if we're not intending to. And the other person on the receiving end can experience that. And yes, I just gave an example of whites as it pertains to people of color, but it works in a reverse as well. This is a bidirectional exchange of nonverbal identifiers that we're giving off to people. And it impacts how we move throughout the world. It's sometimes that meeting is a little bit more tense at work than it has to be, right? Or maybe you're going and you're trying to find a seat on the bus, and who you choose to sit next to and who you don't choose to sit next to. So many different ways that our implicit associations and our biases show up and it impact the cultural and racial climate of our cities. And so that's important to really think about. This quote here is, you all have probably read it at this point, right? it's a quote that I think is really important. It says, it might not have been your intention when you were crossing a road to step on my foot, but the impact of you stepping on my foot, it still remains. That is critical. This actually is a quote from a focus group participant from some original research that the Kirwan Institute did with the Association of American Medical Colleges. And we were looking at implicit bias in academic medicine. And this quote has really stuck with me. Like, wow, that's true. And that's what we're here talking about tonight. It's not about intentions, but the impact, it still matters. The impact matters whether you're well-intended or not. So the question is, how can we begin to change our associations and make sure that our intentions are aligning with outcomes? I'm gonna skip that slide. So to that end, let's actually talk about what we can do, what the research says about how we can begin to guard against our implicit associations that perhaps don't align with things that we're happy about. You may have noticed we've been using a picture of a car's rearview mirror. And this is really important because we know, so we have all these technological advances with vehicles, right? So much you have Google and Amazon, it's like test driving, the self-driving cars, yet and still you buy a 2016 version of any car and you still have a blind spot you gotta be worried about. It's like how you can get a car to drive itself, but you can't figure out this blind spot. But the reality is that's where we are. And we know we have these blind spots. So as you're going through driver's ed, which, you know, may have been recently, maybe not. But as you're learning how to drive, one of the things you're taught to do is to actually turn and check. We know that there's a blind spot there, so we have implemented in the training process of teaching young people how to drive a mechanism by which they can keep from side-hitting someone when they're merging on the highway by teaching them to turn and check. It's the same thing with our cognitive blind spots. We know that we have these blind spots. And so one of the things that I'm hoping to help equip you with is a mechanism by which you can stop for just a second and check. Check that rearview mirror, turn for just a second and ask yourself, question your objectivity. Ask yourself, hey, what's going on here? Is there something else that's happening that should be considered? So good news, neuroplasticity. I feel like a geek because I actually get really excited about this. For me, this is like a really big deal. It's proof that we know that our brains are malleable, meaning we can change our associations. When you actually think of learning and you think of like when we were talking about classical conditioning earlier, learning is literally just the connecting of neurons in your brain, building those connections. And the more you use those connections, the stronger they get, the faster they get, the more they're able to be activated automatically, that unconscious processing we've been talking about. And the more, if you don't use those associations, they actually dissipate. They prune away. They can disappear. You can actually literally, physically rewire your brain connections. And that's exciting. It means that we have control over what associations we're building in our minds. We're not having to walk throughout the world and just aimlessly taking in everything and having no autonomy. We can actually do something about it. The first step is to know your own biases. It's to take this implicit association test, if you have not already, and actually discover what some of your implicit associations are. If the race implicit association test is a little too close to home for you, maybe start with a different one and work your way into the more difficult ones. The main thing is to actually feel that experience, because if you go through that test, you feel when you're like, dang it, I'm making mistakes, I'm trying so hard, or at least I did. It's like, goodness, like I feel this different. You feel the difference. And that feeling really can tell you a lot about what your perceptions are. And you can actually use that experience, that feeling that you get when you're taking that test and you're working through learning what your associations are. You can take that experience and use it to inform other moments where you're making a decision and you feel yourself tensing up maybe when a certain type of person comes near, or you feel yourself having some type of response physiologically to a situation, and be able to question, like, hey, where is this coming from? Maybe there's something there. It's also important to recall those moments where you're more likely to rely on your unconscious processing. It says system one here because there's a theory behind this conscious and unconscious called dual systems theory, but we didn't go into that today. But when there are certain circumstances, so we know that incomplete and ambiguous information, when your cognitive load is compromised, those things that we went through in those exercises, the time pressures, when there's high stakes, things like that, we know that there are moments where we're more likely to rely on our implicit associations. So be cognizant of that and consider that as you move throughout the day. It's also important to take action, and one of the ways to take action is to increase our cognitive control through mindfulness. This is really effective way to change our associations. As it says here, mindfulness means paying attention in a particular way on purpose in the present moment and non-judgmentally. So people, if you say like, oh, you should meditate, someone will say, oh, you got to think about nothing. It's like, but then the whole time you're trying to think about nothing, you're thinking about how you're thinking about trying to think about nothing. Like, it's an epic fail, but that's actually not what mindfulness is. Mindfulness is actually being centered and being present. So oftentimes, if you're having some guided mindfulness, the person guiding you might say, listen to your breath and actually follow your breath as it's going in and out of your body. Be focused on that one particular moment. And yeah, your brain is gonna drift away, and that's fine. Notice it non-judgmentally and refocus it. What that actually does is increase your conscious cognitive capacity. It actually can have the ability of slowing down time for you. So as you're making those decisions, you're more attuned to your unconscious inclinations that may not align with your intentions. This is a really effective way. So even just 5 minutes in the morning, make that declaration. I'm going to do this 5 minutes every day when I wake up. Or if you're like me and you're always late because you're not a morning person, before you go to bed. Another way to take action is to build new associations through intergroup content. This research dates back to the 1950s, and it really has been pivotal in things like Brown versus Board of Education and desegregation of our schools and of our communities, because researchers have known for quite some time now that, you know, if you actually interact with people, you tend to like them more than if you don't interact with them. So there's certain conditions where intergroup contact is more likely to have a positive effect, one being equal status within a contact situation. So for instance, thinking about gender stereotypes as it relates to career fields, most people don't think of a woman when you think of a leader. So if you're in a work setting and you're practicing intergroup contact by having a male supervisor and his female assistant, that's not really effective. You're perpetuating that stereotype and that hierarchy of who holds what position. So having equal status in that contact situation is important. Also, intergroup cooperation and common goals. So working collectively toward a common goal in a non-competitive environment is really key as well. Just a comic here that I think is funny, but if I go over there and get to know them as individuals, what am I supposed to do with my stereotypes? Hopefully change them. Another way to take action and build new associations is through a process called counter-stereotypical exemplars. So actually exposing yourself to images and individuals who defy stereotypes. Again, the primary reason that these two, the intergroup contact and counter-stereotypical exemplars, are effective is because it's literally giving you an alternative association that you can draw from when you're next interacting with the person that you tend to have a negative bias against. It's giving you an alternative to the media messages and the messages that's permeating our society. So you're actually able to better differentiate individuals and see them as an individual as opposed to a collective group. It's also important to, and this is something that applies more at an institutional level. Most of us work and have institutions that we participate in, and so anything that you can do to intervene, create policies and practices at an institutional level to intervene in those key decision-making moments where you're most susceptible to implicit associations, the better. It's a little hard to see on the screen, but you know, it's understanding those moments of high ambiguity, understanding when cognitive load is compromised. So for instance, if you're in a role where you're hiring someone and you're bringing on a new person in your company or your organization, make sure you're not reviewing the applications in the midst of doing all these other things. Maybe you can turn your email off while you review the application so you hear that ding of the Outlook on your computer, and if you're like me, you look over immediately and start ignoring everything else. Push that aside when you're reviewing those applications. Also, recognize when decisions are made under intense time pressure. So where possible, create the space and the time needed for those key decision-making moments. It's important when thinking about changing your associations that it takes intention, attention, and time to do that. You have to actually want to change your associations. And I know that just by virtue of you being here with us tonight, that you are amongst those who are motivated to help and create a better, more culturally inclusive city here in Kansas City. And so you have that motivation. So we'll say check there for the motivation, and I'm holding you all to that. Also, you have to recognize that repetition and self-awareness matters. You have to actually engage and become more in tune with yourself. So you recognize when you have a physiological response to a person or persons that don't align with how you would like to feel and experience them. And then also know that associations won't change overnight. You have to be patient and stay committed. These associations formed after years of being inundated with messages and stereotypes. We have to be patient and work through that and be persistent. It takes time. So some of the final points, and then we're going to have some questions. It's important. I don't want you all to walk out of here thinking, oh my gosh, my brain is doing stuff that I can't control, that I'm not aware of. There's no hope for the future. These unconscious processing, this implicit processing that we have, is not a bad thing. I don't want you to leave this room tonight thinking like, oh my gosh, this is such a terrible thing. Why can't my brain just be conscious? We can't move throughout the world having to think about every single thing. You know, imagine if you're at a red light and the light turns green and you actually have to think consciously about what to do. we wouldn't have any of the technical advancements that we have in our society if we had to do everything consciously. So it's not a bad thing that our mind works this way. It's actually a good thing. The question is, what are your associations? And if they don't align with your intentions and your goals, your values that you declare explicitly, how can you begin to change those? Here's a quote from Dr. Mazarin Banaji. She's one of the folks behind Project Implicit, where the implicit association test is located. It says, the first step to defeating our hidden biases is to be honest with ourselves about the blind spots we have. Having a bias is only human. The only shame is in making no effort to improve. If you are more interested in getting more information about this implicit social cognition, The Kirwan Institute has publications that are free and publicly available on our website called the State of the Science Implicit Bias Review, where we have really synthesized, particularly as it relates to race and ethnicity, what the academic literature says about how implicit biases work, where they come from, how they operate in our society, and also what to do about it. So it's a great resource if you're interested. I also recommended reading, if you're less interested in academic type texts and you're more interested in lay reading, which is most of us, I think, here's a book that's really pivotal. This book was actually written by the Anthony Greenwald, you may recognize the name from the implicit association test, and then also Dr. Mazarin Banaji. It's a relatively recent book. It's one of those books that is really good psychology, but it's really fun read. So don't worry, just like hopefully this conversation, you didn't feel like you were being attacked by me, this book is very similar. Yeah. I'm gonna end with a quote here. It's a little cumbersome, but I think it's really important what it says. If you always think what you've always thought, you will always do what you've always done. If you always do what you've always done, you will always get what you've always got. If you always get what you've always got, you will always think what you always thought. So our challenge to you is to start to think differently so that hopefully you can begin to do things a little differently and get different results. Thank you for your time. So, thank you. So we want to take some questions from the audience. I want to introduce my colleague, Dr. Maurice Stevens. He works at the Kirwan Institute as well. He's our senior faculty research advisor. He's also a faculty member in the Department of Comparative Studies at Ohio State University. Mm-hmm. And he has an extensive background in things related to racial justice as well as implicit and cognition. So he's going to join us for the Q&A. Yeah.
Also, I am live. Good. So I think we have time maybe for about 10 to 12 minutes for questions. That probably means maybe two people at each mic or maybe three people at the mic. But then also,
there's only one mic.
So there's another mic over here. And then Robin and I also linger. So at around, say, 8:05, the official portion of the program will end. People who need to go can go. We'll hang out a little bit for some other questions. Yeah. And so for now, let's maybe a couple questions on each mic. Comments.
This evening's outstanding presentation primarily focused on changing people's attitudes or behavior after they've acquired those attitudes. Mm-hmm. But have you done any research on what place family setting and influence plays in contrast or comparison with our educational systems? Formation of our attitudes as we start out at age zero and go up to adulthood.
You want to start that?
I can. So research has primarily identified early life experiences and also messages from media as primary ways in which we actually get inundated with messages about different people. And so a lot of times we challenge folks to actually take a moment. We have more workshop-based formats as well, where we challenge folks to take a moment and actually reflect on what are the conversations that you heard at the dinner table as you're growing up. Mm-hmm. You know, what were your parents saying about certain sides of town? You know, I like to use the example personally, just being vulnerable, as I've asked you all to be vulnerable with me tonight. I use the example personally of my mother being born in the 1950s, my dad in the 1940s, and they grew up in an era of segregation. And even in Cincinnati, Ohio, there were neighborhoods where you didn't go if you were brown. And there were neighborhoods that you just knew not to go to. And so my mom, my whole life growing up, would always say there's a particular like suburb. It's like an intercity suburb. It's surrounded by the city of Cincinnati, but it created its own like judiciary, like jurisdiction lines. And she would always say, don't go to that side of the railroad tracks. And it's like so cliche that there were actually railroad tracks. But she would always say, you know, you're not safe over there. You're not safe over there. And so it's interesting. It was a white community. And she grew up in an era where you were not safe over there, especially at night. But times have changed. And I can walk in that neighborhood and not get attacked. But I went to high school at the neighborhood right next to it. And I literally like remember how long it took me to stop being scared to go to that neighborhood. You know, because I had received those messages that it wasn't safe. And so that's an example of, as an African American, being told to fear, you know, from a perspective that at the time made sense. It was correct to fear that, but it was no longer something that made sense. And so we are getting inundated with messages from our family that's causing us to have perceptions of different neighborhoods and different people. Do you want to touch on education?
Yeah, the only thing I would, the way I'd come to that question, given the kind of research that I do, is that I would say that there's kind of an always already effect, that in actuality, it's the family is not before culture. The family is not before society. I mean, a lot of times we feel like, oh, there are certain things we can do in the family, and then our children go out into culture, and then they start getting all these sort of effects. But in fact, when you really start looking at how we make family, or even how we imagine family, that those concepts are always already in place even before we start, right? So I would actually say, you know, we can do more work by not getting into trying to answer that particular question, and then just asking, what do we see in place right now, both in the family or in the church or in education or in the media, but, you know, in any of these contexts.
Yeah. Hi, Dr. Wright. My name is Sloan Davis.
Oh, I'm not a doctor. I appreciate it, though.
Well, I know you're probably working towards it, though. So I have a question about, and I don't know if my unconscious mind was working at this time. You mentioned an additional research that you're doing, and after being in the culture of Kansas City, something that may interest more of our ears, our pique our curiosity. So I just wanted to know more about your other research.
A lot of the conversation that has occurred since we've been here has to do a lot with neighborhood divisions and segregation and the climate, the cultural climates from one neighborhood to another. And so there's a lot of literature that looks actually at the housing realm and that looks at how implicit bias actually contributes to segregation. So especially in the policy world, there's a term called NIMBYism, not in my backyard. And there's a lot of research that aligns that notion of not in my backyard to be very much tied to our implicit associations of, you know, what type of housing developments we want to create. You know, if you're trying to put a subsidized housing apartment in a certain middle class neighborhood as a way of diversifying the neighborhood, what type of backlash do you get? And how might our implicit associations of who those people on Section 8 are play into that inclination to oppose or support that housing decision. And so there's a lot of research that looks at things like that. And afterwards I can give you some more specific articles if you're interested in looking into them. Thank you for that question. And I love your hair.
This has been a very enlightening evening. Thank you very much. And even though you're from the Buckeye State, I still love you all, though. I wanted to ask you, you had mentioned the Board of Education in your looking at research and as far as background information. One of the most defining portions of that case was the research that Dr. Clark did with the baby. Mm-hmm. And showing the difference between how black children associated black dolls with white dolls. And when you talked at the beginning about the association test. I wanted to ask you, based on the research that you've done, when you looked at the association of how Black children feel versus other children of color or white children, is that still very much the same type of outcome?
Go ahead, Robin. No, go ahead. I know you want to get on that.
That's a really deep question. So there's actually a video that we, in some audiences we share it, where someone actually did a remake of the doll test. She's talking about the doll test with Kenneth Clark. Mm-hmm. And in that doll test that was redone, I think it was 2008, I may be mistaken, yeah. But really that recent. Right. And the results were the same. Mm-hmm. Same results. Nothing had changed in children's perspectives.
Yeah.
A lot hasn't changed. I won't say nothing.
Part of what's so powerful about this is that a lot has changed. The explicit associations and all the work we do with our kids changes, but the implicit work is what's in place.
Yeah.
Because we're just now figuring out how to start really intervening and mitigating that implicit.
Yeah, so and I will say though, so I guess the silver lining, you know, if we're not optimistic about this, we wouldn't be doing this work. And so as a mother, having a three-year-old, my son is at an age where he identifies differences between him and his friends. Like he knows which friends have the same skin color as him and which ones do, but he does not yet ascribe a status to that difference. So he has, one of my close friends has two little girls, that one a year younger, one a year older than him. He calls them his sisters, and they call him their brother. They're white. And he sees that they're different. He knows that their color of their skin is different, but he does not ascribe a status to that difference. And I bring that up just to say that even though our brains tend to categorize people, right, who's like me, who's not like me, it's not, in my opinion, an innate thing for us to ascribe those differences.
No, yeah.
And so, yes, the results of that remake of the doll test showed that some of these messages are persisting, but as Dr. Stevens was saying, we're learning now about the unconscious mechanisms that's causing those to persist.
Exactly.
And we know that it's not something we're born doing, saying that because you're in an out-group, because you're different, mm-hmm. you're better or worse. So we now are in a position where we can start to challenge those associations and be more intentional about changing them.
Right. Because we're identifying the context in which we're most likely to rely on that cognitive piece of the cognitive process, and we can start targeting that. Last question, and then the formal piece will be done, and folks can leave who need to leave, and then we'll just hang around a little bit.
Oh.
I'll just bend down.
Sorry.
So it seems to me, and this may be an oversimplification, and if it is, I apologize, that most of the changing of the implicit bias was in an effort to be aware of, and then I guess trickle down to the unconscious, from the conscious mind trickling down into the unconscious. I know that there's a lot of research now being done in the connection between the body and the mind,
mm-hmm.
and how that the mind is really mapped throughout the body, and perhaps mm-hmm. that's where a lot of the unconscious mind resides. So I'm wondering if your research has kind of looked into doing body-specific work to maybe change the unconscious mind and trickle up from the unconscious to the conscious, in addition to doing the other way around.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Great question.
I mean, maybe I'll start with that. So I tend, and you know, we have a lot of folks at the Institute, and the implicit bias team is diverse, and we actually, just like you all, we do decide we have a particular definition that we use when we talk to people, but we also have our own internal little tussles about what we think it means. And
yeah.
So, you know, so I actually don't like to use the notion of unconscious
mm-hmm.
because there's this idea, from a psychoanalytic perspective, that it's actually not accessible to us. And so I like preconscious and subconscious, because then you can think about the direction of the work. Is it about things that we're pushing down or things that are trying to come forward? And then if you're thinking that way, then you can actually do work around helping people, not helping, setting up situations, staging possibilities for people to be aware of what's happening for them on various levels. So not just how they're thinking, but actually how they're mm-hmm. experiencing things physiologically. And right now, that's the way that people are first entering into the conversation that you're suggesting, because we have this idea about the mind and body being split, you know, in a very binaristic way. But starting to think about mindfulness or supported self-awareness, if you want to call it that, or even a metacognitive perspective on mm-hmm. knowing that you're learning about something while you're learning about it, sort of what we did tonight, that can be a way to start being conscious about the connection between those things.
Yeah, and I think if you think back to when I was talking about classical conditioning and Pavlov's dog, and I kept saying the dog had the same physiological response, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. that was honing in on that. You know, are we literally, and the reality is, because we have been trained to think of the brain and the mind as being separate from the body, we're not necessarily honing in on the ability to really be in touch with what's going on with us physically. We miss those physiological mm-hmm. Identifiers that connect to what's happening in our brain chemistry. Yeah. Becoming in touch with that, and mindfulness, while it's mind is in the name of it, right? So it's like, well, here we go back to the mind. But mindfulness is actually a really good way of becoming aware of what's going on in your body, learning to be in touch with where you're holding tension, when are those moments where you're feeling things happening in your body. And that can be a really good personal indicator, a way to collect personal data as to where and how bias mm-hmm. may be operating with you.
Another quick piece to that too. So that's about an individual awareness about an individual experience at the bodily level. But another way that I think people get into the conversation about that is talking about, you probably heard, like trauma-informed mm-hmm. understandings of X, right? So part of that's about, oh, let's look at the context out of which mm-hmm. this person's complete experience is emerging. And part of that experience is physiological, right? So mm-hmm. there was a while back, there are these folks who, have you seen these pranking in the hood? Have you seen any of these videos? People will go into neighborhoods, you know, predominantly black neighborhoods, and go up to somebody and say, hey, you know, something like, hey, you want to buy a gun? You want to buy a gun? I'm not talking, you know, you want to buy a gat? I'm talking about a water gun. Or they might say, hey, you got beef? You want beef? You want beef? Same things that were kind of setting people off, right? Mm-hmm. It was sort of like this extreme pranking, right? Like, I'm brave enough to go do this. I'm gonna go set this person off and see what happens. And
I wouldn't suggest it.
No, don't. No, and part of the concept there that kind of overlooked there is that people are very often in certain settings, they are on high vigilance, like constantly. So their physiology is rigged, it's set to go. Right? And that's not just people living in those contexts, that's actually people who go and police those contexts too. Mm-hmm. They're also on high vigilance and they're set to go too. So it takes just a small stressor to set a cascade in motion. But, so that's another way that people get at that, by thinking about trauma-informed approaches to thinking about it.
Thank you so much for your time.
Yeah.